Welcome to Channel 4, the APL video news magazine that focuses on our world and our successes. From groundbreaking historical achievements to the cutting-edge research of today, watch as we explore the lab's innovations and milestones and meet some of the people who've made them possible. For information, for education, for innovation, this is APL Channel 4.
Hello. I'm Mike Buckley of the Communications and Public Affairs Office, and to my left is Angela Atkins, the guest host for today's program. So Angela, what do you do here at APL, and what brings you to Channel 4?
Hi, Mike. I'm in the new Asymmetric Operations Department as the IT Services Lead. My main function is to centralize the IT and associated services within the department. The concept of an APL news channel was intriguing to me. Combining my love of historical knowledge and performance, it was a unique opportunity at APL.
Well, that's a combination that works well at Channel 4. So before we look back at some of APL's greatest moments, let's check on the news happening around the lab. APL is working with the Office of Naval Research to understand how blast trauma affects the brain and to discover ways to protect soldiers from traumatic brain injury. In late September, a team from the Research and Exploratory Development Business Area conducted live fire tests on its human head surrogate model. APL designed sensors in the head, track brain displacement, and measure acceleration and pressure. The test showed two separate phases of brain response during blasts, and researchers believe both correlate to brain injury. The model will help the military understand the risk of injury and to evaluate helmet systems.
The Navy's Tactical Satellite 4 launched on September 27th from Kodiak Island, Alaska. TACSAT 4 is an experimental spacecraft that will test several communications technologies, including some to improve mobile communications for troops in the field. APL worked with the Naval Research Lab and a team of government and industry experts to design and build the spacecraft as part of a program to develop standards for a satellite that can be used for a variety of national security space operations.
Here's news that APL is a healthy place to work. This month, the League of American Bicyclists will present the lab with a bronze-level bicycle-friendly business award. The League applauded APL facilities and programs such as showers and locker rooms, secure bike parking, in-the-zone incentives for healthy living, and support of a cycling club. In May, APL posted the Baltimore area's best participation in Bike to Work Day and recently picked up some riding room when Howard County painted a bike lane on Johns Hopkins Road. Our first feature today takes us back to the Cold War era. The Russians had just launched Sputnik, pushing the U.S. into a national security calamity. Yet from this crisis came transit, the technological grandfather of GPS and one of APL's most successful heritage programs. Let's find out more from the APL vault.
Today, a new moon is in the sky, a 23-inch metal sphere placed in orbit by a Russian rocket.
With the surprise launch of Sputnik on October 4, 1957, the Cold War between the Soviet Union and the United States entered a new theater of operations, space. That historic event would also herald a quantum leap in navigation, the global positioning system. As the Soviet satellite orbited Earth every 96.2 minutes, it emitted radio signals that anyone on the planet could monitor. Two of the people who finally decided to listen in were APL's William Geyer and George Weifenbach.
When the Sputnik first went up, we were all home for the weekend, and we were listening to the television, and everybody, I'm sure, like us, were excited. When we came back Monday, we were all talking about, and I remember at lunch, George Weifenbach and I just happened to sit have lunch together, and that wasn't a common occurrence. And everybody was talking about it, and to suddenly realize that everybody was talking, but nobody had been listening.
With each pass, the signal rose and fell in a particular manner.
We were all intrigued with the shifting frequency that we thought initially was maybe a instability in the oscillator, until some of us thought of it must be the Doppler shift.
One Friday night, Frank McClure suddenly understood one potential breakthrough of Geyer and Weifenbach's research. McClure later recounted, "If you can find the orbit of a satellite, you sure as hell can find the listening station on Earth from the orbit." McClure called Robert Kirshner that night, and the two spent the weekend working through the basic concept of a satellite-based global navigation system. The next Friday, he summoned Geyer and Weifenbach for a visit.
He called us into his office and said, "Close the door." And that was always an indication that either something very classified or something very important or both were going to start. And he very briefly asked us if we thought we could know, if we knew the orbit, could we find the station? And with a few minutes thinking, we said, "Sure." And he started outlining what he thought about the importance of navigation.
Despite doubts among the nation's astronomers of McClure's vision, the lab pressed forward quickly to take advantage of the concept of GPS. It would give the United States a tremendous strategic advantage to be able to precisely locate its naval vessels and especially its Polaris nuclear ballistic missile submarines. The Navy's Special Projects Office was a prime early supporter of the technology. In 1958, a $250,000 grant from the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, the precursor to the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, gave APL the funding it needed to turn its ideas into reality. The name Transit was chosen, as all APL projects of that era began with the letter T. APL engineers built the first transit satellites on their own and completely from scratch. There had only been three satellites launched at that point, and two of those were Soviet-built. This was the frontier of the space age, and APL was creating one-of-a-kind satellites, receivers, trackers, computers, programs, and dozens of other subsystems. To control transit, the satellite needed to have a computer. That computer needed to be programmed. Those programs were some of the largest in existence at the time they were written. APL scientists built the first computer with memory ever launched into orbit. The satellite's computer needs, electrical requirements, and projected time in orbit, 5 years, required serious power. A nuclear power plant, the first used in space, was designed to power Transit's batteries.
At the time, there were no space-qualified batteries. We were using hearing aid batteries that were developed by the Sonatone Company as batteries in our spacecraft.
On September 17, 1959, just 9 months after ARPA's initial grant to APL to develop the program, Transit 1A launched from Cape Canaveral. The launch vehicle malfunctioned, sending Transit 1A into the Atlantic near Ireland. On April 13, 1960, Transit 1B was launched. Four more launches soon followed, and by late 1961, APL's small constellation of transit satellites was operational, providing GPS data to the U.S. Navy. Transit not only provided global positioning data, it revealed fascinating details about our planet. For one, that the Earth was no sphere, but rather a lopsided ball. Transit's findings even led to the start of the work on the theory of continental drift. Though APL's pioneering work would eventually be supplanted by other global positioning systems, the transit satellites continued to provide GPS data until the program was officially ended in 1996. The satellites continued to serve the Navy after that, and transit follow-on programs like OSCAR continue to operate to this day. From a lunchroom epiphany to the creation of a mini-satellite industry to far-reaching Earth science discoveries, APL's transit program remains one of the lab's most inspired achievements. Did you know APL researchers have been working in biomedicine for more than 50 years? Informal collaborations between APL and the Johns Hopkins Medical Institutions began back in 1964. The Biomedical Program Office was first officially established in 1973. The lab's first biomedical patent, filed in March 1965, was granted for a micrometer-controlled leak-proof syringe. By 1982, more than 100 new medical instruments, clinical information systems, and sensory devices had been developed at APL. Examples include the rechargeable pacemaker, the ingestible thermometer pill, the programmable implantable medication system, or PIMS, the single-use syringe, and the mass spectrometer for biomedical applications.
In our second feature segment, The Edge, we highlight a specific area of technology, look at where it came from and where it might be going, be it sea, land, or space. Today's Edge segment follows APL's unmanned aerial vehicle technology, from the most rudimentary models to today's swarming UAVs.
Unmanned aerial vehicles, or UAVs, have become an invaluable tool in the new asymmetric conflicts that challenge our nation. Descended from hobbyists' radio-controlled model airplanes of the late 1930s, UAVs today are state-of-the-art 21st-century aircraft. Modern UAVs are high-powered, fully integrated machines that perform intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance missions, as well as combat operations all over the globe. And new technological advances are being combined by APL researchers to create even more capabilities for UAVs. Modern UAVs are a relatively new tool that evolved from radio-controlled airplanes. Two of the pioneers in that hobby were Walter and William Good. Walt Good came to APL in 1942 to work on the VT fuse. Though he spent much of his 35-year career at the lab in ballistic missile and submarine research, Good continued to work on radio-controlled aircraft. One of his protégés at APL was Maynard Hill, a metallurgist who had joined the lab in 1960. Hill shared Good's passion for building and flying model airplanes, and both men knew there might be something more to their hobby. By the 1970s, as electronics began to shrink, the idea of using UAVs as battlefield tools became more feasible. A decade later, Maynard Hill's X-Drone project demonstrated the capabilities of this new generation of UAVs. X-Drone was demonstrated for the Marine Corps as a battlefield electronics and communications jammer. The fiberglass X-Drone was powered by a chainsaw engine. It was launched by a Chevy station wagon pulling back on a bungee cord. And it was so invisible to radar that metal reflectors had to be added during testing in order to track the craft. By 2002, robotic software research had reached a point where APL researchers began to develop new ways to use UAVs in concert rather than as individual aircraft. In 2005, APL and two industry partners began developing a network of weaponized UAVs. The craft would use stealth technologies and carry precision-guided weapons or precision miniature munitions. These UAVs would have a new level of autonomy in the battle space. The network would have situational awareness, perform analysis and reaction, and, with some level of human interaction, coordinate precision surveillance and attacks on hostile targets. Earlier this year, APL participated in a test of new swarming software and an ad hoc communication system that enables groups of UAVs from different manufacturers to work together to perform complex tasks. This is a crucial asset as UAV use continues to increase across different services and agencies, both military and civilian. From the days of Walt Good's radio-guided wooden planes to autonomous packs of hunter-killer stealth aircraft, APL's legacy with unmanned aerial vehicles dates back to the very first days of the lab and continues today with some of the field's most cutting-edge technological achievements.
Education is a main driver for the lab's success. Our ability to deliver critical contributions hinges on our knowledge, experience, and plain old know-how in science, technology, engineering, and math. And to make sure that success continues, we can all do our part to find and inspire the next generation of STEM experts.
So in our final segment today, we look at the STEM outreach programs that exist at the lab. We'll also look at the new STEM program office and how this initiative will help the lab and the country in the future.
Very nice. The nation and the world are facing some amazing challenges in the future. And science and technology, of course, can't help with everything, but they can contribute in many ways to a lot of the problems. And the nation's workforce has been going down significantly in the STEM area. And it's important that we bolster that workforce. And we have to start efforts in that area very early on.
Sparking students' interest in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics at an early age is a goal of the many nationwide STEM-focused programs. At APL, STEM programs have been going strong for decades. Many staff members on their own time volunteer to teach, mentor, judge science fairs, and be role models for students that want careers in science and technology.
The need for STEM is pretty critical.
In July 2011, APL named Dwight Carr, an engineer from the National Security Technology Department, as the first program manager for the new APL STEM office.
It's been projected that in the next 10 to 15 years, we're going to have a severe shortage of qualified engineers, scientists, mathematicians, physicists, all of those people, that small percentage of the population that we depend on for our economic development. The era where we had the most engineers graduate from college and enter the workforce was actually during the Apollo era. And a lot of those engineers are actually the engineers we still have at the laboratory, or were inspired by those activities that the country was engaged in at that time. Since then, we really haven't had a real push or a national mission for everyone to get behind that would encourage this next generation of students.
Some APL STEM programs are well known. The Maryland MESA program, founded at APL in 1976, works to promote students' interest in mathematics, engineering, and science. The High School Mentor Program brings gifted high school students to APL to work one-on-one with a mentor throughout a school year for academic credit. And Space Academy is one of the lab's most visible STEM programs. It brings middle school students to APL to learn about a current space program. Students tour the Space Department facilities, participate in a press conference, and view a science show.
Ask for a file name. In this case, we want to start with a square.
Some staff members have created their own STEM outreach programs, like Eric Farmer, who has volunteered to teach programming to advanced students at Lime Kiln Middle School for the past several years.
Not so much on just computer programming, but on applications using the computer as a tool. Thinking about problems in mathematics, in physics, in engineering in general, that the computer is suitable for helping to solve. I personally feel like it's important for APL to have a vested interest now in these very bright and capable minds, but if we can continue to maintain their interest in the kinds of educational fields that are useful to our workforce, then I like to think that in the near future that the same students that we're interacting with now will end up coming to APL.
Numerous other staff members continue to participate in a variety of STEM initiatives. All of these efforts show that APL is not only giving back to the community, but is also committed to strengthening tomorrow's workforce.
Events like this serve to excite the kids, motivate the kids, and hopefully a number of them will not only go into STEM, but develop an appreciation for STEM if they go into other disciplines that will benefit the nation and the world as a whole.
That was wonderful. STEM Outreach and the new STEM Program Office are doing great work. If you or someone you know at the lab is involved in local, regional, or global outreach programs, please let us know. You may be the next staff profile on Channel 4.
Thanks, Angela. Now that wraps up the third in our initial series of three episodes. We want to say thanks to the Ignition Grant Program and to all the staff who voted for making Channel 4 happen. Remember, you can watch us on video on demand via APL VisionNet and join us in our Cooler Group where we exchange more ideas and information. For all of us at Channel 4, I'm Mike Buckley.
And I'm Angela Atkins. Thanks for watching.